My name is Erzsébet Chai Vashahei, or as I say as an American, Chai Vassarelli. And I wanted to thank you all for having me here today. I'm very proud to say that I am half Hungarian and half Chinese. My father is Hungarian, and he was born here in Budapest, and my mother was born in Hong Kong. When I was little, you know, I was the child of two immigrants to America, so I've spent kind of in the summers, because both my parents worked, to spend a lot of time with my Hungarian grandmother, who I was named after. Her name was Erzsébet Vashahei, and she had a lot of friends. They were this lively group of older European women who had fled war-torn Europe for sunny Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. So I was sent every summer to Rio, which was very nice. And they'd meet and play bridge in the afternoon. I never learned how to play bridge, but I'd sit and watch and listen to these formidable women fluently switching between European languages as they talked with each other. One woman was German. Her father had been a general. Others were Polish and French. Some were Jewish. And they shared stories of loss, love, survival, and braving this new life in Brazil together. As they play bridge, they were actually forging bridges with each other. And I was this English-speaking, half-Chinese, half-Hungarian kid from New York who got a window into their remarkable lives. Even then, I was this outsider looking in, you know, and from a young age, it made me realize how fascinating it can be to be just that, an outsider looking in, which is kind of a definition of the artist, isn't it? So spending time with my grandmother and her friends led me on the way to becoming a documentary filmmaker. But it also made me realize that it's okay to have multiple identities, to be able to live between worlds. That not being entirely of a single place can actually be a good thing. It can give you perspective. It also taught me to cherish the stories we tell about our lives, especially the ones that may fall between the cracks. So my Hungarian grandmother and her bridge club inspired my first film, A Normal Life. In 1999, I was probably the same age as many of you are now, and yet another war was erupting in the middle of Europe, this time in Kosovo. You know, Bridge Club had taught me to look for a common humanity, to find people like me who lived in Kosovo, but happened because of their geographical, political, and ethnic circumstances to be victims of war and genocide. Eventually, A Normal Life, my first film, won the Tribeca Film Festival, and I went on to make a few more films on my own, and eventually a couple with my husband, Jimmy Chin, who's here today. Hi, Jimmy. And together we won the Oscar for a movie we made called Free Solo. I don't know how many people here have seen it. Has anyone seen Free Solo, maybe? Okay, well, a few. It was an amazing ride. What happens when you win an Oscar and your last name is as Hungarian as mine is, Vashahei, people in Hungary notice. I have a very big Hungarian family, but I've only spent, you know, a little bit of time in Hungary, but I do like a lot of Hungarian things. I grew up with szekély goulash, tokaj, a lot of fermented cabbage. I've played a lot of Bartok. You know, Hungary was very much part of, and also poppy seeds, like every poppy seed sweet I would love. And my children, whose last names are Vashahei slash Chin, hyphen Chin, also appreciate those Hungarian things, especially the cabbage. You know, but I guess, like, that makes me kind of a prominent Hungarian artist, which is why I am here today. I know that all of you, should you want to pursue a creative life, you will become prominent Hungarian artists too. I remember when I was graduating from school, just like you, I hoped that the person who was in my position up here on the stage, you know, would give me the keys to figure out my whole life's journey, or at least how to start it. The truth is, I don't remember who spoke at my commencement 20 years ago, and the world has become a lot more complicated. And I'm still confused about how my life's journey is going to work out. Like, every day, it's still confusing.
But I know that a few things are true, and I'm going to share them with you. And I really believe these things are true even with AI. And just as an aside, my father is a professor of artificial intelligence, and I still think that these things are true for artists. One, you're great on your own, but you're better with each other. Look around you. Look at your friends and classmates, professors. This is your network. They may even be your family, your tribe, these relationships that you've created here at school. This is one of your greatest assets. The friends and connections you've made here, they will be your best collaborators, your most ardent supporters, and your fairest critics. Lean on them, work with them, listen to what they have to say. Even today, some of the people I trust the most are people I went to college with. We have this common ground. We studied the same things, faced similar challenges. I know where they're coming from, which has been essential in, you know, creative feedback on my work. But more to the point, they've made me realize how the creative life may seem like a solitary endeavor, but it's richest as a collaborative adventure. I made some work I'm very proud of. That said, I've made some work I'm very proud of before I started working with my husband, Jimmy. But I think the work we've made together has even more weight or gravitas or reach. You know, I think I personally bring a sense of emotion and story, and he brings so much. We can do anything spirit, and a visual scope and spirit so far beyond mine. Neither of us could have made Free Solo on our own. And yes, we needed Alex Honnold and his amazing gifts of climbing and determination to make it too. But Jimmy and I were able to pool our strengths and make it together. And I think it's an exciting piece of filmmaking that made a ripple in the world because of that. And for those of you who don't know, Free Solo follows Alex Honnold, who's this individual climber, as he tries to climb El Capitan in Yosemite, which is a 3,000-foot, you know, wall of granite without ropes. And it, you know, it was celebrated as one of the greatest human athletic achievements. The film, it does capture a climb, but it's really about many more things. Basically, kind of the endurance, the vision, the determination, and the mental strength he needed. And I highly encourage everyone to see it if you haven't seen it already. Okay, so my second point is don't be afraid to ask for the world, as long as you're okay with accepting a no. And this one's like a really important like kind of rule for me. I'm not gonna lie, but getting your first no isn't easy. Getting your 100th no isn't easy. Getting your 10,000th no really sucks. But every once in a while, you'll get a yes. But if you don't ask for what you want, you won't even get an answer. You don't stand a chance. So after Free Solo, we had made this film that won an Oscar. Jimmy and I decided to make a movie called The Rescue. I don't know how many people have seen it, but you've probably all heard of the story about the Thai soccer team that got stuck in a cave. It was a group of 13 children. And you know, it was a story that everyone knew around the world. It captured people's fascination because they were stuck for about 2 weeks and no one could find them. And there was lots of news footage, but no actual footage from inside the cave. So I'm not sure how you made a movie about something with no footage, especially a documentary. So while we were making the movie, I heard a rumor that the Thai Navy SEALs had actually filmed inside the cave, but they were an elite special forces military group that had no interest in showing their faces or sharing classified material. The admiral of the Thai Navy SEALs, though, is married to a former journalist. And she suggested that the SEALs carry cameras and film the operation. But this wasn't publicly known. It was a rumor. I so desperately wanted the footage for the film. And you guys, I'm sure, will desperately want things for your creative work. I was haunted by it, obsessed by it, you know, but there was a pandemic. And we met virtually on Zoom over and over again with a representative from the Thai Navy SEALs, speaking Thai, English, like no one really understanding what was going on. And, you know, we received a no 1,000 times, easily. And I'd be like, let's have one more Zoom, please. This took like a year and a half. But for me, like I could only stop if I knew I had tried my best, and that meant meeting with them in person and asking them myself and taking the no to my face. So, you know, once I got a vaccine, I got on a plane to Thailand. I did my 2-week quarantine that no one told me was dry, meaning there was no alcohol until I got there. At least that got a laugh, okay? So I arrive and all I wanted was a cold beer, couldn't get it because it was a dry 2-week quarantine, and I watched a lot of Netflix. Anyway, once the 2 weeks were up, I went and literally arrived at the Navy SEAL base in Phuket, Thailand, and knocked on the door. And please, will you meet me? And upon seeing me, understanding the lengths I went to, they did say yes. And I have to say, you know, that film, it ended up being like they gave us 90 hours. They sent a military escort with the footage. We had to blur all the faces, but they trusted us. And it ended up like 17 minutes in a 90-minute film. And it made the film, I would say, easily 100 times better. But again, it's like, just ask for what you want. They can say no, you can ask again, but just keep on trying. Third, okay, this one is also quite important to me, is no matter how good your work or your art is, it won't and it will never speak for itself. Trust me, I know it's very hard to be creative. It's hard to buckle down and make the work you want to make. So much of what you see in your head doesn't end up on the page or on the canvas or on the screen, and it's extremely personal, often painful to share any of that work with the world. I honestly don't even know which of those steps is the scariest. They're all quite scary, but you have to take another scary step too. You have to sell the work. You have to self-advocate for it. You have to make sure people see it or read it, that they feel it. You know, mostly it's terrible and painful and embarrassing, but you have to do it. Think of it as part of that creative process. And I have to say, like, as a woman, this was a particularly powerful lessons for me, especially, and also as like an outsider who kind of never really fit. Like, I was biracial, I was American, but I was also part Hungarian. Like, it was always kind of on the fringes. And I remember I always felt that the work would speak for itself, so I'd just make the work really good and people would notice. And it was only after I heard this woman, Marissa Meyer, speak, and she's like, you know, women, like, men are gonna always talk about how great their work is. Like, women, you've got to speak up too. And it was like a lightning bolt for me. And it like fundamentally changed how I talk about the work. And I think I can't stress this enough. Okay, there's a lot of stuff out there. You have to represent and advocate for your work. And also it's really important to be able to articulate your work. You know, have a clear sense of how to talk about it. Okay, number four, it's okay to have audacious, crazy, outrageous dreams. Dream as small as you want to, or as big as you can. I believe you'll be able to accomplish so much of what you want as long as you have the work ethic and the determination to see it through. So much of my work is about people who have audacious or crazy dreams and have accomplished them. Alex Honnold climbed El Cap without a rope. Audacious, dangerous, life-threatening, not necessarily human or sane, but Alex believed he could do it, and so he kept on trying. And he didn't give up, and he succeeded. The divers in the rescue, they believed they could save those kids in the cave. Others were skeptical. I mean, basically the whole world was skeptical. Another audacious, dangerous, life-threatening journey, but these divers were deliberate, thoughtful, and they didn't give up. They believed they could do it, and they did, and it was a miracle. We're putting the finishing touches on our first narrative film, which is like basically a fiction film that's based on a true story, but it has actors in it. It's about Diana Nyad. Diana Nyad believed she could swim from Cuba to Florida. This is a 110-mile journey and would likely take up to 60 hours. And that means you can't stop. You've got to swim for 60 hours straight. She tried it first when she was 28 years old. She failed. 32 years later, when she turned 60, she was like, the world may be done with me, but I'm not done. So she tried again, and again, and again. And on her fifth attempt, when she was 64, she made it. And guess what? To this day, she still holds the world record for open water swimming. You guys are probably too young to know who this is, but Annette Bening is 64, so she plays Diana Nyad, and Jodie Foster is 60, and she plays her best friend. And so we've been kind of on that kind of adventure for the past year. So it's important, it's so important to tell these stories. We need to absorb them, to let them soak into our consciousness, to remember that the limits of what we can do are kind of limitless. Okay, and so this brings me to my last point, which is try to change the world, even just a little bit. You know, the most recent documentary film that Jimmy and I made together is called Wildlife. It's about these amazing older people, Chris and Doug Tompkins. They were both incredibly successful in business. Chris helped, was the first CEO of the Patagonia company. You guys have heard of Patagonia. And Doug Tompkins started the North Face. He started Esprit. They gave corporate life up, you know, in midlife, and to preserve, like, to pursue this idea, this life of conservation in South America. Doug has since passed away, but Chris has continued this amazing environmental journey. It took us, I mean, about 8 years to make Wildlife. We made other films in between, but yes, from beginning to end. The process definitely involved following lessons that I've spoken to 1 through 4. It was only after the movie was released, that I realized how it actually changed my life. You know, I started having conversations with people who'd seen it, with young people, with critics, you know, with my kids who are here today too, with older men and women, like my grandmother's friends in Rio. In every response to the movie, the conversation always underlined every little thing counts, and that we have agency to make change. Doesn't have to be big, you don't have to save 17 million acres. You have the tools today to make some change, especially as artists. I've learned that films, that really any creative pursuit, has the impact to make change. And I hope that we can encourage everyone to do a little something, whether it's as small as using a reusable bottle or just paying attention to the trees when you're outside. We need to take care of our planet and for each other. And our creative methods are really the best way to go about it. I've so enjoyed being with you today, and I can't wait to be inspired by the work that you make. Best of luck to all of you.